Cyprus and Slovakia, though not by Wales. It's the final score at the end of the European Championship Group D qualification campaign is Wales 2, Republic of Ireland 2.
Now we're going to look at the Group D table as it now stands. And there you see Ireland with 17 points, Wales with 14. We can be overtaken, as George said, by Cyprus and Slovakia, but that requires them to win both their remaining matches. So you're making the point, Eamon, that it doesn't really matter one way or the other whether we're third or fourth.
No.
Explain, because people think it's desperately important that we finish third.
It's not important. The seedings, there's the top two tiers. If you're in the top two tiers, it's a big help because you get slightly easier group. If you're in, whether you're in tier three or four is a matter of no importance, because there are so many moderate teams in those bands, and also the seedings don't always reflect, in fact they never reflect, the true strength of nations. So you can read far too much into it, and it's really nonsense. Where we're seeded, whether we're in the third tier or the fourth tier, doesn't matter. So we can.
I wonder though, and I asked you this already, I think, would it matter to a potential manager?
No, the potential managers watching that game today would have, I hope, come to the conclusion that there's some very good players in the Irish team, and that Stephen Ireland, Richard Dunn, would have to come back into that.
Damien Duff
potentially coming back into the reckoning as well, and would have, I think, looked at the attitude of the Irish players in a situation where it's a temporary manager, and I think it was a very commendable attitude. I thought they really are good lads. They want to play for their country, and that is not universally the fact.
Yeah.
But a lot of players now in the Premier League, they don't care whether they play or not. And I think it was a good advertisement for the Irish squad, and unfortunately they gave a goal away. But I don't think McShane is quite the place. He's not a Premier League player. He's not a top player. And he was found out today. I've always thought he's an accident waiting to happen at this level. Wales also have a couple. Kumas is a very good player, which you pointed out before the game, and Davis. They played very well. They played some good football, Wales. They just don't have the players. They don't have enough players of quality. But, you know, I think there's a lot to look forward to now if we get the right man.
I'm intrigued, though, at your point about McShane. I wonder, do you two guys share that view?
I would, yeah, Bill. I like him. I love his attitude. He's a great attitude. He's a great lad. Great-hearted lad. He sees everything in front of him and he goes for it. But he lacks pace, Bill. And I think he also lacks a real reading of the game.
Yeah.
But his attitude is, I mean, like, as all ex-pros here, when you see lads with attitude.
If you're too slow and you don't read it properly, attitude isn't much good, is it?
It's great to see.
Yeah.
You know, if you see a lad making the best of what he's got. But if they're ultimately, if they're not good enough, they're not good enough, Bill.
John.
And today he definitely was exposed.
I've got a great attitude. You know, there's loads of people with great attitude. In international football, you've got to either read. John Terry has no pace, but he reads the game well.
Yeah. You're missing the point, Eamon. Who would you pick?
I would pick Richard Dunn and John O'Shea.
Yeah. Richard Dunn's not there.
No, I'm not saying he shouldn't have played today. I'm saying if you're looking at the best possible side for Ireland, Richard Dunn and John O'Shea.
Oh, yeah.
John O'Shea actually did quite well today, but there's one glaring example in the second half where he didn't pick a man up from a free kick. If John O'Shea got a slight change of attitude and a coach that talked to him and made him do certain things, he and Richard Dunn could provide a very, very strong central defence for Ireland.
Well, you made that point before the game started, just talking here off air, and you said that's the central partnership that you wanted to see.
Yeah, and I have to be fair to O'Shea, I thought he played very, very well today, apart from the lapse at the free kick where he just ball watched. But there was a lot more commitment and concentration about his game today. And I think with, like, size-wise, physically he's got everything. He's not slow either, John O'Shea. And
Does he read the game well in your judgment?
Well, he does. He's a very experienced player. He's played a lot of Champions League games for Manchester United. And with Richard Dunn, I'd agree with Eamon, you want to see if that partnership can work. Now, McShane is the only other viable option after that. So
you want McShane's attitude with the
he could play
John
right
O'Shea.
Yeah, he could play right back, McShane. You know, he can cover
you wouldn't
for center.
Discard him, would you?
Well, you can't discard him, Bill.
Haven't got
we're
the
just
options.
We're just not blessed with the numbers to discard him. And I think he'll learn. As it goes on, he'll learn. He's still only a young lad.
John?
Well, all players learn, hopefully, Bill. You know, his attitude is great, and I know I keep coming back to that. And you know what you're going to get from him. You know his limitations. He's not quick, and he's always struggling. He's desperate a little bit, and today exposed him in that particular way. But he'd be a valuable member of the squad.
If the referee had given a free kick outside the box and hadn't led to anything, we wouldn't have been discussing McShane. He didn't have a bad game at all today.
Now, what about the options coming forward, though? Like, Bruce was on the bench, or Dee was on the bench from Celtic. No, you say no?
No. No.
You don't see them as World Cup viables?
No, we don't have strength in depth. What we do have, we have 14 or 15 players that are top players, I think. People like Shea Given, who was great again today, who's been injured this week, could easily have pulled out of the squad. Richard Dunn. Steve Finnan would need a kick up the backside, and probably at 32, 33 years of age, we're not going to see him getting any better, that's for sure.
He seems to have been dropped by Liverpool rather than rotated, hasn't he?
Well,
he didn't
perhaps.
Play the last Champions League.
He looked very heavy-legged today, and in the match against Cyprus, I thought he didn't really put in a performance. But there's a lot of positives. The Doyle-Keane partnership today looked much better and looked a threat all through the game. Young Hunt is good. Andy Reid can play, maybe not as a midfield player. In my opinion, he doesn't have the engine to go box to box, but he could certainly play wide on the right, come in on that left foot of his, and has a very sweet touch and can deliver the ball. This squad of players needs to be organised and motivated by a really good coach, and I think they'll be a force, and I think they'll qualify for the World Cup in 2010. They've got every chance, in my opinion.
Otherwise, you'll be in Burton's window, will you?
Well, no. otherwise, unless I get the job myself, I'd give up this game. My application's going in on Monday. I've got to have a word with him.
He wants to talk to somebody. That's obvious.
I'm taking him out for a few McCarty's tonight. We'll know in the morning.
Right. That's water, by the way, in case anybody was wondering. Time for another break. We'll have more discussion and analysis in just a few moments. Well, we're back in Cardiff's Millennium Stadium next Saturday, this time for Rugby International, when Wales host world champion South Africa. That's a game that shouldn't be missed, and you can see it here live on RTE2. Our build-up begins at 2:25. So it finished Wales 2, Ireland 2. Was that, John, was that the right result? Or was it a game, realistically, against an inferior team that we actually threw away?
Well, I think if you're leading right up to the last couple of minutes of the game, Bill, you're obviously disappointed when you do that. But I think overall it was a pretty fair result. I mean, there were long spells in the game where Wales played particularly well. Shea Given had to make a couple of saves.
Oh, indeed, he did. We still didn't.
So I would say it was a fair result. We probably had the better chances in the match. But that was a good game of football. Both sides tried to play.
It was entertaining.
Ireland, we got into a winning position and then just lost in the last couple of minutes. But I'd say overall, it was a pretty fair result.
No, Liam, you were making the point that it was a match that Ireland should win because if you went through the Wales team, a lot of them were playing in what we'd call in the old days the third division.
A lot of the young lads playing at lower level. John Toshak, again, not quite as bad as us, but not blessed with many resources. So he's had to blood a lot of young lads this campaign, and particularly the right back looked out of his depth today. But to be fair to Wales, they kept going, and they were led really well by Kumas and Davis in the middle of the park. Given did make a few good saves. So either got no complaints about the result. You would maybe want to see Ireland, when they are in the lead, be able to administer the game better than they're doing by keeping the ball and taking the pressure off just by possession alone. But we didn't do that. We maybe did it in the last 3 or 4 minutes and looked like we'd weathered the storm. But unfortunately, the referee gave a penalty there, which was debatable.
Now, I have to give you the credit of suggesting at half-time that Miller should come off.
Thank you, Bill.
No, in fairness,
it was a no-brainer, Bill. I don't like to be
and
modest. It goes against the grain. But it was a no-brainer. Hunt brings something to the party. Miller was having a nightmare in the first half, kept giving the ball away, wasn't getting his tackles in, and really isn't quite up to it, at this level. And Hunt, substitution was a no-brainer, and Don did well. He saw it and he did it, and as soon as Hunt came on, He had an immediate effect on the match, and he continued to have an effect on the match. He's a great attitude. He's a good left foot. He's a great attitude, and he was always going to hurt that young right back, where Miller was really creating more problems for Ireland than he was making contributions. So that was a good substitution. A fair play to Don for making it.
Yeah, and let's have a look at the impact that substitution made. The first the Irish goal in the second half put us ahead 2-1.
Yeah, I mean, this is literally his first kick. He's played in here by Robbie Keane. And the kid, he's facing up to him now, never gets close enough. And he curls a beautiful ball in. And Kevin Doyle does really well to score. It's a natural goal scorer's goal. He goes in off his thigh. But the kid should have closed him down, hasn't got a clue. But Hunt sees the opportunity on the near post. And Doyle makes the run. And that's the benefit, maybe, of playing together for a long time at Reading. And it's a fine goal. It puts Ireland in front. And that was his first contribution to the match. But he went on then to contribute all over the field. He's a terrific attitude. And he's got some talent as well.
OK. No, he wasn't, of course, the man of the match. The man of the match was Robbie Keane. He's talking now to Tony O'Donoghue.
Yeah, I think we obviously dominated the game, and there's no way we deserve to for them to get something out of the game. You know, it feels like a loss to us because, you know, when you concede in the last few minutes of a game, it's never nice, and you know, I think that's probably summed their campaign up. You know, conceding late goals, so you know, which was a bit of a shame. But I think it was positives from the game. You know, we played well, and we always looked like we're going to score. We looked a threat, the whole team. So. In that respect, it's positive, but as I said, it's never nice when you concede in the last few minutes. It always feels like a defeat.
When we conceded the first goal, we came back into the game very quickly with your 32nd international goal. Great ball from Kevin Doyle for you as well.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was a great ball for Kevin, and it just made me run, and I knew he was gonna find me. And, you know, thankfully I put away. But you know, we responded very well because it's never nice when you go goal down, especially when you're playing away from home with the crowd getting behind them. But I have to say, your crowd was absolutely fantastic again today. Like they always have, but through the whole game they were fantastic, and you know, they got us going after we conceded the first goal, and then we got back into the game, and with a great finish by Kevin. We just, as I said before, we just got that we conceded in the last few minutes.
It may be enough to finish third in the group. I know that's no consolation. You'd want to qualify, and yet when you look back at the campaign now, what can you take from all this?
Obviously, you know, we're not stupid. You know, we haven't done as well as we'd like to, but we have to understand. You know, we're a small nation. We haven't got the players that the Germany and the Czech Republic have. People expected them to go through anyway. But you know, we regroup now and look forward to the friendly in February, and look forward to the next campaign, and hopefully we can do a lot better.
And look forward to a new manager.
Yeah, look, yeah, if it takes over, you know, we look forward to working with whoever takes in charge.
Thank you.
Right, I suppose, Johnny, it's legitimate to think it feels like a loss, isn't it?
Ah, well, of course. I mean, when you're leading with the right up to the last minute, Bill, it's always, you feel as if you're going to play out the clock. And the funny thing was with the Irish team, it was, and I don't want to go back too much, but it was actually from a corner kick.
I know.
That we knocked. And it's just that those little things can.
What is that, a lack of concentration?
Well, it usually is when you knock the near post. We see it so often. But, you know, for the sake of getting the ball up in the air, it could be bobbling around the air, you might score. But it certainly wouldn't have happened the way it happened. But it shows you how important those little things are, particularly at that stage in the game. But I think when you lose a goal in the last minute, player or your supporter, you do feel a bit jittery. It's like when you score a goal in the last minute to equalise, it feels like a win. But that's the way it
is. No, in studio, you guys were not at all impressed by the referee. So let's look at the penalty. And in your judgment, John, was it a penalty?
I think McShane definitely fouled him. What I'd like to see, if we see a close-up, Bill, is whether it was inside the penalty area. Now, he's definitely fouling him there. Now, you know, it's debatable whether it was just inside or not. You know, you'd want to see it if we can see it, if it's possible.
Well,
to
let's
see it again.
Can we see that again? Yeah.
You can do it in slow-mo, if possible.
And if possible, in slow-mo.
I think he did foul him. I think he got the wrong side of the player, and he hasn't got that much pace to get back. And I think that's where he was really struggling. You know, he's on the wrong side of him anyway. He's from this close-up now. I think he's definitely fouling him there.
And is he inside the penalty area?
He was fouling him for about 15 yards, Bill, and he ended up falling inside the box.
He should have abandoned the foul, if you know what I mean. Once you start, the box was looming, he should have put his hands out because he was out on an angle. Mm. He had it all to do to score from there or to make a goal from there. And I think McShane showed a little bit of inexperience. He just should have ceased contact with the player because it was getting near the box and he didn't do it. Bill.
And it was inevitable that the ref would give the penalty, wasn't
well,
it?
Well, yeah, to be fair, he finished a few yards in the box and it was difficult for the referee coming from behind to see exactly what happened. But as soon as he went down, I knew he was going to give a penalty. Yeah.
If you're Welsh, you would say he was definitely inside.
Definitely, of course. Or if you were Irish and it was in Dublin, you'd say the same.
Definitely.
All right, we're going to take a break. 2-2 in Cardiff. We'll be back shortly with more analysis and discussion. Welcome back. 2-2 in Cardiff between Ireland and Wales. The Irish team was in charge, under the care today of the caretaker manager, Dan Gibbons. He's talking now to Tony O'Donoghue.
Don, you obviously would have wanted to win the game, but how pleased were you with the performance?
Yeah, I thought the performance was quite good. I really did. We needed that third goal to kill off the game. You know, we started quite well. Aidan McGeady kind of, you know, gave him problems very early on. And then we went the goal down from nowhere. So, but, you know, I was always confident that we were going to get back into that. Robbie got us back in, and at half time, the players were very confident. I was very confident that we would go on to win the game. I thought we dominated the second half, played well, got the goal, a few more chances which went a-begging, and we suffered a little bit of a counterpunch in the end. So it's very disappointing. The lads are really down in there. I'm obviously very disappointed because we wanted those 3 points. But, you know, we asked for a better performance, and I think we got it.
He did well, Liam, didn't he?
Yeah, I'm disappointed for him. He hasn't got an easy job being Irish under 21 manager, Bill. And forget about the results of the under 21s, because any decent under 21s we've got are in the full squad. So Don's always going to be struggling to get results. So he's a disciplinarian, and he really has a pride in playing for Ireland. And I think he instills that into the young players in his charge. I'm disappointed he didn't get the result. I would have really wanted him to get that win today.
Now, before we finish the programme, let's look forward to some of the positives. And let's look at one of the anchors, I'd say, in the World Cup campaign, and that's Shay Given in goal. He had a super performance today, hadn't he?
Absolutely, Bill, yeah. Three top-class saves. This was off McShane's head, and that's the best of the three we're going to see. The others are shots from long distance that you would always fancy Shay to save, but that's showing his agility tremendous. This was Kumas, given a little bit too much room, but given deals with it, as you would expect he would. But a poor goalkeeper might let that in. He watches it all the way. And this is an even better save from Kumas's free kick. Going in the top corner, coming back at him. Shay very nearly went across it because the ball was swerving. And a touch there, maybe that wasn't so important, but I think he's a top-class goalkeeper, Bill.
Best goalkeeper we ever had, really. And we've had some good ones.
Yes, yeah, without doubt.
Best we've ever had.
Yeah.
And we've had some good keepers. Mackie Bonner and Alan Kelly. I think the best we've ever had.
Yeah.
Best, okay. Now, if we reflect back on the campaign before we look forward to what might happen in the World Cup, we did well, John, didn't we, against the top teams?
Well, considering we didn't play well in the group, Bill. I mean, before the matches started, you got the Czech Republic, Germany, and everybody's fancying them to be the top two teams, which they turned out to be. But if you look at the two matches we played against them, you know, one goal separated the teams in the two matches. You know, with Cyprus and all that that let us down. So even Germany here, the no score draw. Czech Republic here, the 1-1 draw, and 1-0 away from home. So it shows you there's not that big a gap.
Yeah. Between. So a more focused.
More focused team organised
direction,
well,
and
we'd be able to shout. You know, okay. I think all of us agree. There are no great teams out there, Bill. But obviously you've got to do your own stuff to do. We didn't do that. But I'm only making those examples of the teams that the top teams that we played. You know, two draws at home and 1-0s away from home. So weren't that far away.
Okay, all right. And some of the players who will be hugely important on the way forward, of course, will be Given, we've already seen, Dunn.
Richard Dunn. Yeah, Richard Dunn, I think, has emerged in the past 2 years in this group as an outstanding central defender and an outstanding leader. I think he's saved us time and again when we would have got a hiding. I think Andy Reid has come in the last few matches, but Dunn has been amazing. He really has. He was a bit overweight, he was a bit undisciplined at Manchester City, but he's become one of the best central defenders in the Premier League now, and he's been magnificent for Ireland. In Slovakia, against the Czech Republic away, against Germany home, he's really been great. And Reid, Look at his face. He's really, really dogged, and he's got pace. He's good in the air. He attacks the ball at the right time when it comes in the box. He's got a big heart, and he organises people around him. And he's got guts. And ability and guts is an unbeatable combination, and he's got them. He's a wonderful young fella who's turned his career around. Now, Andy Reid has got a lot of ability. I don't think he's got the engine to go box to box. But if you can accommodate him in, say, a 4-3-3 system and get someone else to do the donkey work, he can pick out a pass. He's a beautiful passer of the ball. He's got a lovely left foot. And he's not afraid to get on the ball and want it. He's quite confident as a young fella. So if you've got to take budget for the fact that he's not going to be a box-to-box player. He doesn't have a great engine. But he's got a lovely, sweet touch, and okay. That's important.
Right, now the young ones, Liam, that would be Doyle in Ireland and McGeady.
Yeah, well, I don't know who's going to come up first. It's Kevin Doyle. Well, he showed his worth again today, didn't he, Bill? Good goal. His record at scoring international level is very, very good. He's made a big impact at Reading in the Premiership. And this was a great goal against Slovakia. That was another game we should have won. Robbie Keane mentioned that. That was a tremendous goal, probably the best goal we scored in the campaign. This is Steve in Ireland. This lad, we need to sort out this lad's future. And I think the next manager needs to get over there and say to him, like, come on, we need you, get you back in the fold, because he's invaluable. He's one of those midfielders who scores goals. A bit like Lampard, a bit like Fabregas. You need those guys in the team. And McGeady, well, I was pleased to see him do well today, because we have been critical of him, and he's a player with undoubted ability, but has lacked the end product. He has been better in recent weeks for Celtic, and today he played a very good game for Ireland. And if you can get end product from McGeady, he's going to be a valuable member of the squad.
Now, one final, very brief answer I require from this one. If you were a potential manager looking in, what would you have taken out of today?
Very positive outlook, I would have said, Bill. Considering the players that performed today, and also the ones that weren't there, Eamon mentioned them, Duff, Dunn,
Stephen Ireland.
Mm. It's a good squad of players.
Right, that's it. We've run out of time. Ireland's Euro 2008 campaign has come to an end. It would be remembered for a failed gamble in appointing a rookie manager at the helm of the Irish team, perhaps best illustrated by a gloomy night in Nicosia when Cyprus put 5 goals past a hapless Irish team. But of course, we can never forget that historic day in March when Steve Staunton led Ireland out in front of over 70,000 fans in Croke Park, one of the real highs of this campaign, and a remarkable moment in Irish sport. The next scheduled game is against Brazil in February next year with a new manager in place, by that time, so one would expect anyway. My thanks to John, to Liam and to Eamon for their thoughts this afternoon and indeed throughout the campaign. And we leave you with some of the moments that marked the past 14 months of Ireland's Euro 2008 endeavours. From everyone here in studio, bye-bye.